Good morning. Welcome to another exciting episode of In the Stacks by the Sea from the Georgetown County Library System. I'm your host, Dan Turner, Public Services Librarian, and we are here at the Waccamaw Library in Pawleys Island, and we have a very special guest with us today, Tom Santapietro. And Tom is a wonderful piano player, very talented, and he often graces us free of charge. He comes in and plays piano, his wonderful improvisations, his stylings, very creative, on rock, jazz, blues, little boogie-woogie gets in there sometimes, classical, spirituals, just about anything and everything you'd like. He'll come in and he'll play before events for us for 45 minutes, so you get an extra event before an adult program here. And sometimes I feel like he might be the main draw. It's sort of like when Jimi Hendrix opened for the Monkees back in the day. But he's wonderful, and he does that, for example, before First Thursdays, and I mention that in particular because his wonderful other half, I won't say better half.
Oh, it is the better half.
They're both they're pretty good, but Jill Santapietro, she really got First Thursdays rolling here, that wonderful lecture series, and then passed it on to me, and I'm trying to keep the momentum going, but she's a wonderful member of our Friends board here and member of the community with the chamber. Tom is here with us. He's going to play some tunes for us. We're getting them recorded on the piano here, and he's going to talk to us. He's got some great stories about his life in the music industry and maybe some other things. And I do want to mention this. Tom was very instrumental in helping us get this new piano for the library, which sounds great for him to play, but also any other performers who come in, they get this great piano.
You may want to mention Mike Bavona and Ruth Lale, who were as equally instrumental in getting this piano.
Yes, and they.
Mike Bavona and Ruth Lale asked me if there was anything they could do for the Waccamaw Library, and my suggestion was they have the backyard project pretty well in hand. We could use a piano. And he said, fine, go out and get one. So we went out and got one, and the three of us got together, and here it is at the library, and now I get to play a good piano.
And it is a good
excellent piano, Kawhi, I might add.
Yeah, and they took care of all the expenses
for it.
Wonderful, and Mike he also put on some shows for us, some...
really interesting shows.
Yeah, live theater, sort of variety shows.
Exactly.
And Tom, you played the piano for those as well. So, so great stuff. And thank you, Tom, for being here with us to sort of brighten our morning on what's been a very rainy morning outside. So, Tom, could you tell us a little bit about yourself? Where do you come from? Who are you, Tom?
Well, I'm originally from New Jersey. Lived in New Jersey all my life. About 13 years ago, we decided to get out of New Jersey, and we came down to South Carolina. I had been coming here to play golf. My wife wasn't familiar with the area, and on a plane ride back, she asked if we could possibly move here. And at the time, my wife was a breast cancer survivor, and thank God she's been cancer-free now for about 17 years. It's really been a blessing that worked out. And we ended up moving down here, and I had not been playing the piano for a while. I had a little accident with my hand, and that coupled with life, I kind of put the piano on the back burner. And when I got down here, I realized that you can only play golf and go to the beach so much. I decided I would start playing the piano again, and we have a nice big grand piano in the living room, and my wife is pretty gracious about me banging on it loudly. She's now decided to take walks every night while I practice. Can't blame her. Wish I could do it. But other than that, came down here. My history in the music industry was, I'd taken 12 years of classical piano growing up. I hated every minute of it, but my father was adamant about the fact that Tommy had to play an hour every day or I couldn't go out. So what turned out to be something I didn't really like, it ended up being the greatest thing in the world because I started to play in bands all through high school. And we had a couple of managers that booked us as the opening act for the Young Rascals and a couple of pretty major gigs. Long story short, I ended up having a regular job in a piano store, selling pianos and delivering them. And one day the gentleman who owned the store asked me if I would help his cousin deliver a couple pianos. Well, I helped him deliver the pianos, and he was a nice Italian man, and he asked me if I wanted to work for him, and I asked him what he did, and he said he did PA. And I said, what is PA? And he said, well, PA is public address. Well, in 1970, I guess that's what they called it. So he asked me if I wanted to work with him, and I said, sure, you know, give me a call. Well, a couple days later, he called me up and said, I got a job, we're going on the road with a band. Would you want to go? And I went, sure, and he offered me $75 a day, which was big money back then. And I asked who the band was, and the band happened to be the Beach Boys. Well, the irony in that is, the first band I was ever in eighth grade, and one of the first songs I ever learned was In My Room by the Beach Boys. And I thought it was really ironic that 8-10 years later, I get a job as a sound technician with the Beach Boys. Not knowing very much about professional PA at that scale, it was a learning experience, and it was probably the most musical time of my life in a sense that I got to set up stage for the Beach Boys. I got to play the 9-foot Steinway piano on the stage through thousands of watts of amplification. And actually, Carl allowed me to play in between shows for a half hour or so, which was exciting. I will say at the time that I was probably a much better piano player than I am now, in a sense that I had just got through taking 12 years of classical piano, and I was pretty well versed on all the songs that were popular in those days. And being 21 and wild and crazy, and I might add the statute of limitations are expired, so I can say some of these things. It was a pretty exciting time for a 21-year-old. The end of the story is I was offered a job with the Beach Boys in California if I wanted to go out there and move. But there was a lot of questions, and I was doing a lot of stupid things. I thought it would be better if I stayed in Jersey. So my boss bought a 9-foot Steinway piano, and he gave me the International truck, the 9-foot Steinway, a 7-foot Baldwin, 2 Hammond B3s and 4 Leslies, and I delivered them to all the venues in New York and Pennsylvania and New Jersey for the next 3 or 4 years. The end of the musical career came when I met a girl, and I was doing sound for Kiss at the Sunshine Inn in Asbury Park. And when I looked down at the chair where she was sitting, she asked if I was going to do that the rest of my life. And I said, probably not. And that was the last show I did. I ended up taking a job in a bar playing piano. And the owner decided to change from piano play music to go-go dancers. He then offered me a job as a bartender. And I took it because it was steady money. And that led to about 20-some years of being a general manager in a restaurant. By the way, that girl is no longer here. We call that PJ. That was pre-Jill, Jill okay. Being my wife. After that, I left the restaurant business and I opened up a picture frame shop and did that for 10 years. And that's when Jill came down with breast cancer, so we kind of changed our plans and decided to come down here in South Carolina. And it was probably the best move we ever made. It's just a beautiful area, even with the rain today. And being bored of playing golf and going to the beach, I started practicing my piano again. And when Jill started doing the programs over here, one day one of her speakers was late. And she asked me if I would play the piano. And it was like the first time I played in front of people in a good many years. And especially since I had lost these fingers in a snowblower accident, it was kind of scary. But then again, I said, what the heck? And so that started it, and now it's been about 2 or 3 years, and I'm getting better with it. The fingers haven't grown back, but you know, life is good. I always say my wife loves me, the cat loves me. That's all that's important.
Are you sure the cat loves you?
Well, that's never.
Yeah, it's a little. Yeah. You never know with cats.
Well, I'm pretty sure the cat. Yeah. It's Jill.
Oh, Jill.
Jill,
yeah,
I'm a little,
yeah, of course. Yeah.
That's, she's got better taste than the cat.
Yes, that's true. But she's the tougher haul, yeah, tougher catch. Yeah. And that's, you know, I know having you, I know I'm good having you as the opener here. Because, first of all, it makes people happy. They're in a good mood coming in when you're playing.
And the price is right.
And, you know, we've been talking about doubling your salary. You
please,
know,
please.
Two times zero is still zero. So, but it's, yeah, it's wonderful. And thank you. It is very generous.
It is I have to tell you, it's the highlight for me. It really is.
I know it is. I love hearing it. And I know folks out there, it really does. They enjoy it. And I know I always get asked, is Tom going to be playing? It's, you know, people do love showing up for it. And if somebody is
going to show up for your gigs.
Or if they're on island time showing up late.
Or your movies that bingo, don't work sometimes.
There's some technical difficulties, then, you know, we could. I know I've got it covered. I don't have to start reciting poetry or giving a lecture on,
true,
you know,
true,
on poetry techniques, and they would much rather hear you. But let's cut right now and hear a song. Hear, okay, some of the 12 years of piano training. Tom sitting at his piano because his dad made him, Tommy, but I think it paid off.
I think so.
Let's hear that. That was great, Tom.
Thank you.
Let's go into, how about, can you share a couple of stories from, you mentioned those wild times in the music industry. Can you share a couple of stories that you can tell at this point that we won't have to call the police on you for?
Okay. Well, I guess one story that I think is pretty funny. I was delivering an organ to MacArthur Theater in Princeton for a Bonnie Raitt concert. And I was backstage, I had delivered the organ, nothing to do, just hanging around. And this really pretty girl was sitting on the steps and she asked me for a light for her cigarette. So I smoked at the time, so I gave her a light to the cigarette. And at that point she said, gee, I wish I had something else. Well, long story short, I said, well, let's take a walk out to my truck there. And so we took a walk out to my truck and we were sitting there enjoying for lack of a better term, herb.
We'll delete this part out. We'll bleep it out. Don't worry, Tom.
Okay. Well, the bottom line is...
It's legal.
It wasn't
it's legal,
legal
in Colorado now, so...
Well, we'll move the story to Colorado.
Yeah, this was in Boulder, Colorado.
Yeah, okay, right. At MacArthur Theater. So the bottom line is, we were sitting there, and I happened to turn the radio on to get some music, and the song came on, and the DJ said, you know, it's 8:10, and da-da-da-da-da. And when he said 8:10, this girl said, oh, my God. And I said, well, what are you worried for? What? She said, I'm late. And I said, well, big deal. What are you late for? Bonnie Raitt? Big deal. She said, I'm Bonnie Raitt. Well, you know, that was the end of that story. So that was one story that I always thought was a great story.
Yeah.
I have another crazy story that has to do with Ian Anderson from Jethro Tull.
Oh, wow.
I delivered a piano to Madison Square Garden for a Jethro Tull concert. And while the piano was on stage, it had been tuned, and some guy walked over to the keyboard and he kept hitting this note, and he was complaining that the piano was buzzing. And I knew the piano wasn't buzzing. It happened to be coming from the amplifier, the speaker that they were pumping it through. So I walked over to him and I politely asked him, are you the keyboard player? And he said, no. And I told him to get the F off the stage. Well, when I said that, it was like E.F. Hutton talked. The entire crew on the stage stopped. And to my benefit, this guy didn't say anything. He just turned around and walked off the stage. Well, three guys came up to me and said, do you know who that is? And I went, no, he's not the keyboard player. That's all I was concerned about. Well, that's Ian Anderson, who is Jethro Tull. Well, once again, I didn't think much of it. So I went home, came back that night to pick the piano up, and in the during the show, I was backstage standing, and he had taken his flute solo, and he ran off the stage to take a break while somebody else was doing a solo. And he come running past me, and actually walked past me like maybe 10 feet, stopped and turned around and came back to me and said, hey, you're the guy that complained about, that told me about the piano this morning, right? And I said, yeah, and I thought he was going to be really upset. And he said, well, I just want to apologize. He says the buzz was in the speaker and not the piano. So to this day, I've always liked Jethro Tull, but I respected him a little bit more because of that.
Yeah.
I have some Beach Boys stories, but, how can I say this? The Beach Boys were a really good band playing Beach Boy music. Mm-hmm. But if you were there at 3:00 in the afternoon for a sound check, they weren't the greatest rock and roll band. Now, they did have 6 studio musicians along with the 4 Beach Boys. Brian was not on the road with them. The interesting part about that was that one day their announcer, John Parks, was late for the gig, and they needed somebody to bring the Beach Boys on stage. And they said, anybody want to do it? And I was kind of crazy. I raised my hand and said, sure. And they told me the 5 things I had to do, the European tour, photo registration, Transcendental Meditation, a new album in Holland. And I went, sure, I'll do it. You know, what the heck? Well, I walked out on stage, and that Super Trooper light hit me, and I realized I'm standing in front of 20,000 people, and it was scary.
Oh, yeah.
And I went ahead and did it, and walked, you know, ladies and gentlemen, the Beach Boys, and walked off the stage. And after the show, Carl came up to me and said, you know what, if you want that gig, you can have that gig for the rest of the tour. So the best part about it was the first person that the audience saw for the concert was me. And I was really nobody. I was just a sound technician. But it afforded me some kind of notoriety because obviously I was the first person they saw. It was a really great experience, but scary because it's 20,000 people scares the heck out of you.
Public speaking is one of the top 5 phobias of, you know, generally, you know, the death and disease and all, you know, all these terrible things falling from the sky. And, you know, so public speaking is right up there, and you were doing it in the, you know, the most intensive possible way.
And I have to tell you, honestly.
But you did it.
The first time that they let me play piano, which was pretty interesting. In between shows, there was a problem with the Beach Boys contract, and Carl said, if you want to go out and play for 10, 15 minutes, go ahead, and I'll just give you the sign to cut it off. And I was kind of a little crazy, so I went out there and closed my eyes.
There's a pattern developing here. You're kind of a little crazy.
I was a lot crazy.
And you did it.
But I'm pretty straight now. long story short, I went out and I sat down at the piano, and there were probably maybe a couple hundred people in the auditorium, and I closed my eyes and I started to play. And at that point, I had known all these songs and I really didn't have to look at the keys. Well, maybe 5 or 10 minutes into it, I kind of opened my eyes and looked out into the audience, and there were like 8,000 people. Yeah. Well, my legs started to shake so much. I was so happy that it was facing the back of the stage. And all I could think about was, oh my God, don't yeah. even let them know anything. So anyway, Carl gave me the sign to cut it off, and I finished with the last song, and I stood up to walk off, and I would say 8 or 10 or 12,000 people applauded. Yeah. And wow. I can tell you, I have goosebumps on my arm now. It was the highlight of my musical career. Yeah. It also said that I don't think I want to be a superstar. I don't sing. If I sang, maybe Billy Joel wouldn't be Billy Joel. Maybe it'd been Tommy St. Peter, which was my stage name at the time. But here we are in South Carolina with a beautiful photographer, video
yes.
photographer, and a very well-established music library director.
Programming. Yes, I guess.
Who
yes.
I might add, my wife has said that you've done an excellent job taking over the programs.
Well, that that means a lot. Thank you for saying that.
No,
that means a lot,
you really,
considering the source.
No, you really
did
do.
A great job.
She said she couldn't have left it in better hands. Well, so.
I appreciate that very much, Tom. And thank you for acknowledging Heather. I meant to acknowledge Heather Pelham, who does a wonderful job.
Excellent.
Wonderful. This is just one of her many tasks for the library, which is all, and the county, really, videography and editing and making everything better. So that's a great story. And you do it in parts here at the library, you know, making people happy, playing the piano. Not quite as big a crowd, but
okay.
overall, yeah. you kind of build it up, but still doing a great job. Let's hear it again.
Want to hear another song?
Yeah, let's hear another song.
Thank you.
was a roadie's life like back in the day? What was it like day to day?
Okay, well, back in the day, you would probably, let's just pretend that we got to the gig at, say, 12 noon, okay? Mm-hmm. And with the Beach Boys, which was predominantly the group that I work with, they had 30 microphones, and they very seldom had opening acts. Probably in the 8 months that I was with them, I would say they probably had maybe five or six opening acts. Mm-hmm. Chicago, the Ides of March, or Ides of whatever, I'm Your Vehicle. Act. I just remember a few groups, because it was such a pain in the neck to set up for a other group, rip it all down, and then try to set up 30 microphones for two shows. So you would get to the gig at around 12 noon, and it would take about 3 hours to set up the stage. After you set up the stage, around 4 o'clock, we had a sound check. And that was, to me, exciting, because I got this, our sound company said that they wanted me to play the piano so they could set the house EQ. So at around 4 o'clock, I would sit down at this great grand piano in all these fantastic venues, and I'd get to play anything I wanted for 10 or 15 minutes while they set the house EQ, which is also the way Carl got to hear me play and Dennis heard me play and stuff like that. So anyway, at 4 o'clock, the sound check would be done. The Beach Boys would come in around 4:30, 5 o'clock, and they would do a sound check for a half hour, maybe an hour. By 6 o'clock, everything was finished, and between six and the first show, which was eight, as a roadie, we had 2 hours to solder connections that didn't work, take a shower, eat something, or whatever. The show would start at 8, and barring no problems, the show would end around 10. 10:30, the second show would start, and it would end around 12:30. And between 12:30 and 3 or 4 in the morning, we would pack the truck, and by 4 or 5 in the morning, get in the truck and drive to the next gig, which was 300-400 miles away. In Europe, we didn't have to drive a truck. They gave us a Mercedes, and they hired a truck driver who drove, which I got an interesting story about that, too.
Okay.
We were doing a gig it was called Jahunda Hall in Munich, Germany. And it, ironically, was also the first place where I got to play piano in between shows with that 8,000 people.
Yes.
Well, when we... The truck that we had rented was an English lorry truck, and it had a flap on the back that dropped down, and you could roll stuff out of it. Well, on the side of the board, our mixing board, was in a big box, and on the side of it was the spare tire for this truck. Well, the truck had gotten to the gig before we did, and we were just pulling in. We were probably maybe a couple hundred yards away, and they dropped the gate on the back of the truck down. And with that, the tire that was on the side rolled out. And it rolled down. It rolled about, nobody could stop it because it was a giant tire. It rolled about 30 feet, and it hit this glass panel on the concert hall, which was probably 12 feet by 20 feet.
Oh, boy.
And it crashed through this glass panel. And I mean, we were in a Mercedes with the air conditioning, and I can still hear the glass falling. Well, oh my God, what a to-do that was. But there was nothing, you know, we could do, and I don't know who ended up paying for it, but that was an interesting little story there.
Yeah.
Got a couple of others that are, I don't know.
Speaking of glass tinkling, let's tickle the ivories here, a little better sounding event here with take another cut to the piano, and then we'll come back to maybe another story from the road.
Okay.
Don't go anywhere.
Okay. Thank you.
wife likes, which is...
I know you've told me before that you had a kind of you were in Europe again, and you were staying with a lady who knew
the Beatles.
Okay. And so she was an interesting character.
Okay. Well, when the tour was over, we had about 10 days to kill. Mm-hmm. And we asked our boss Joe to pay us some money so we could spend some time in Europe. Well, he didn't want to pay us any money. He said, come home and I'll pay you. Well, we had 10 days to kill after being on the road for 6 months or so. Long story, we sold some of the equipment we had to Yes, the band Yes.
Yes.
And my boss was upset, but when he realized we got three times the price for a Crown amplifier, so we each three of us, our sound guys, had like a couple $1,000 to kill, time to kill. Well, we needed a place to stay. There was this lady that called up, and she wanted to get together with the bass player. And the bass player had his girlfriend or wife with him, so it didn't really work out. But she also mentioned that if anybody needed a place to stay, she had a boarding house, we were welcome to rent it for $3 a night. Well, we weren't psyched on it until she mentioned that she also rented the other four rooms out to college girls. So okay. Me and my roommate said, well, what the heck? So anyway, long story short, her name was Miranda Ward, and we went to her house, and we stayed there for like 5 or 6 days. Well, on her fireplace, she had pictures of the Beatles. She was a columnist, and she had pictures with the Beatles and autographs and whatever, and she said to me one night, would you like to have dinner with Paul McCartney? Well, thinking she was a little crazy, I went, yeah, sure, tell him to bring Linda, you know? So the next night, she planned it for like the next night or two nights later, whatever. I was hanging out with Yes in the studio with Rick Wakeman, who he also thought I was somebody big with the Beach Boys, when in reality I wasn't. I was just trying to cop some licks off of one of the best keyboard players around. Well, in any event, when I came back for dinner that night, it was around 7 o'clock, 7:30, and I got off the bus off of the Hammersmith Bridge, and her address was 93 Castle now. Boy, I can't, 48 years ago,
yeah,
I can remember
good.
That. So the bottom line is she was standing on the front porch with her arms crossed, and I got out, and she looked kind of pissed. I said, is something the matter? And she said, well, you know, you're late. And I go, for what? She said, Paul and Linda have been here for like an hour now. And I went, oh, I better go apologize. I still, at this point, didn't think it was real. Well, the bottom line is I walk in, and we open these French doors to go into the living room, and here's Paul and Linda sitting on the couch. Well, I mean, I couldn't even talk. I couldn't believe that was actually happening. So, and he was ready to leave. So it was probably a 10-minute encounter.
Yeah.
I didn't know what to say. I'm sitting next to the biggest musical genius around, and he came to have dinner with Miranda to meet me.
Yeah.
Now I'm sure he probably doesn't remember this, but it was such a highlight that I to this day, I'm so upset with myself that I didn't get a picture or anything, you know. But and he's still alive too, I might add.
Yes.
Small point. His birthday is my wife's birthday.
Ah.
So June 18th, a week from yesterday, Paul will be whatever he is, and I'm not going to mention what my wife will be because it's about 35, 36.
That's my mother's birthday too.
June 18th?
Yeah.
Wow, small world.
86.
God, I could have dated her. No, I'm just you can edit that one out.
Thank you for that. 86, yeah. Well, that's amazing.
A couple crazy. You know, I have to say, I was playing music all along in those days in different bands and acoustic and whatever. And then to be exposed professionally to it, it was really exciting. But after a while, it was a strange world. And you had to be very careful about not doing something that would kill you, because there were things around that could kill you all the time. Interesting, one of the first shows I did was for Black Sabbath.
Oh, wow.
and the roadie, his name happened to be Tom, too, but he spelled it T-H-O-M. I remember hanging out with him for the entire day, and at some point outside, I said to him, "So how old are you?" Thinking he was 45, and he said, "I'm 28.
Oh.
And I went, "28?
Yeah.
And he said, "This is your first gig, right?" And I said, "Yeah." He said, "Well, I'm going to give you a big bit of advice." I said, "What's that?" He said, "Speed kills." And I guess speed was the drug of the day then. I wasn't into that at all. But when he told me he was 28 and I thought he was 45, I took that to heart. So
occupational hazards.
Yeah, knock on wood, I'm still here. So
that is.
You can edit that one out too. No.
that sort of sobering there. But just a sampling of the bands, you know, Kiss, Black Sabbath.
Oh God.
Beach Boys, obviously, but you know, you were with them.
I'll tell you another interesting story too. This is a good one. We got hired to put the piano on the stage for Watkins Glen. Watkins Glen was a couple of years after Woodstock.
Yeah.
And so my boss gave me a 9-foot Steinway and a 7-foot Baldwin. And I went up to put the pianos on the stage in Watkins Glen. It was 300 miles from Central Jersey. So put the pianos on the stage. Before I put the pianos on the stage, we usually get paid. And the rule is you pay me before I put the piano on the stage, because if I put the piano on the stage and you don't pay me, there's no chance of me getting paid.
Yeah.
And the piano's already there. So the promoter didn't have the money that day. And he said, "Well, put it on the stage and I'll pay you tomorrow." And I went, "That doesn't work that way." Well, anyway, he had these passes that would allow you all access everywhere. Long story short, I made a deal with him. I said, "I'll tell you what, you give me one of those passes so I can go everywhere backstage other than just the pass to go certain places."
Yeah.
"And I'll put the piano on the stage." So I put the piano on the stage and he gave me that pass. Well, 3 or 4 days later, backstage of Watkins Glen, they had a whole bunch of trailers, and one trailer was just music equipment for the bands to come in and sit and jam. So it's 3 o'clock in the morning one night and it's pouring rain out and I got the pass to go anywhere. So I go into this trailer and there's a piano in there, electric piano, and a lot of, a lot of drugs.
Yeah.
I'm playing the piano and this guy comes in and he says, "Hey, that's pretty good." And he picks up a guitar and I was playing Let It Be. And I was trying to tell him the chords were C, G, A minor, F. And he really couldn't grasp the chords. So he said, "You know what, just play and I'll jam." So I just played. We played for about an hour and he jammed. And, you know, "Hi, my name's Tom. Hi, my name's Jerry." And that was the end of it. Didn't think anything of it. Next day, I'm standing on stage and they're doing a sound check. And this guy comes walking past me with the guitar. And he says, "Hey, Tom, I really enjoyed that last night." I said, "Yeah, thanks, Jerry." And the guy next to me says, "Wow, you know Jerry Garcia?" And I went, "Who's Jerry Garcia?" "That's Jerry Garcia from the Dead." Well, it was just Jerry who couldn't play C, G, A minor, and F last night. So, you know, it's funny. When you meet people that are superstars, you realize that they put their pants on just like you every day. And some of them are nice and some of them are stuck up like Billy Joel.
Oh, really?
Yeah. That's another story. We'll leave that one for another time.
Okay. Well, but, I mean, this is almost like it's if we made a movie of this, it almost sounds like a sort of Forrest Gump type, you know, you're just sort of magically walking through and these people are, you know.
And I never realized how exciting it was when it was happening, you know. I mean, if somebody would have said 50 years later, you're going to look back on this and wish the hell it lasted forever.
Yeah.
And I often wonder what would have happened had I taken the Beach Boys up and moved to California.
Mm-hmm.
The best part about that is I met my wife and we're still together, so that's the best part about not going to California.
It's a happy ending.
It's a, yes.
And who, you know, there's always the road not taken or Exactly. You can always think about that.
That's right.
Well, do you have regrets?
Not in the least.
Yeah.
I've been blessed with a woman who is exceptional, and to my amazement, she still loves me, I think.
More or less. You've got the cat, if not.
Yeah, yeah. I got the cat, right?
You got the cat.
But, you know, no, life is good. I have no regrets. I just wish, my mother had a saying, you get too soon old, too late smart. And that was always on the refrigerator magnet. You get too soon old, too late smart. Yeah. If I had to do it all over again, I'd have never got my hand caught in a snowblower. But I probably would have went to California just to see what would have happened. Me and Dennis were pretty close friends. Every time they came back into Jersey for the next couple of years, he would call me up for medicinal needs. And we had some good times. But once again, I can't stress it enough. I was 21 to 25. And so I would beg to say that that was my excuse for being crazy. And now I'm just stupid. But took the words right out of your mouth,
yes,
right?
Yes, that's if there's a time to be young and crazy,
that's it.
Or to be crazy, it's when you're young.
So. Maybe we should go to
a
song.
Let's do a song again. With the words of wisdom, we'll let the piano talk for a minute.
Okay.
There. Left you want to say? Or
what I want to say is I was never exposed to this library when it first started out, and with Jill doing those programs, it kind of opened my eyes to what a wonderful facility that's here. And if you're new to the area, you owe it to yourself to join this library and its sister library in Georgetown. It offers wonderful programs. The price is right. The people that are here that work really try hard to do everything to make it more comfortable for us. So when you get a chance, go on the FOWL website, Friends of the Waccamaw Library, or the Georgetown County Library, and do what you can to help this facility, because it really is an asset to the community.
Thank you. We did not pay, again, time completely unpaid, but we appreciate that truly. We do thrive and survive and thrive on wonderful community members like Tom supporting us, and we very much appreciate that. And that's what we are.
That's right.
Like the old the church in the steeple. We have wonderful buildings in Georgetown County library system. We have those because of the people.
Yeah.
And all the way up, Dwight McInville, our director, is wonderful, and the people we have here. But it's really the community, it's the people who support us.
Exactly.
And our friends group, FAO here and Fogle down in Georgetown. That's what makes us a special place, and it is
exactly.
Very special, and the programs and everything else. So thank you for saying that, Tom, and thank you so much for all you do and that Jill has done for us here at the library. And thank you for the music. And I think before we let you take us out again with the last song, is there any chance that you could maybe get the Beach Boys to come play here, or Sir Paul McCartney? Either one will take. It's a nice venue.
Yeah, I'll send them a little text to see what they're doing. Of course, you realize now the only Beach Boy that's left is Brian, and I met Brian 3 times.
I was going to ask that.
Well, I met Brian 3 times,
okay.
And our conversations were about as much as me talking to this piano. He just sat in the room, and it was in Europe. It was right after our tour. They were setting up the studio for their Holland album, which ironically had 2 new members, Blondie Chapman and Ricky Fitar. Blondie played guitar and Ricky played drums, because Dennis never played drums on tour. He would sing out front.
Yeah.
So meeting Brian was exceptional, but the other side of the coin is he didn't say anything.
Yeah.
So I don't know if he's doing road trips right now, huh?
He's an interesting
And Paul,
one.
I don't know. I can give Paul a call. His birthday's next week.
Yeah, wish him happy birthday.
Yeah, right.
See if he'll stop
Yeah, Paul,
stop
remember
by.
Me?
Yeah, for Jill's, maybe
right,
do
yeah.
it for Jill
maybe
and
he
my,
can
my mother.
Sing happy birthday.
Yeah. So it's your birthday.
Happy birthday.
He'll,
yeah, right.
he'll sing the Beatles song.
There you go.
We'll see. We won't hold our breath.
Okay.
But those are awesome stories, and I know you have many more. So.
Well, I'm looking forward to you doing the programs again with people, and I'll have some more stories.
Oh yes, that will be wonderful to be able to really open things back up again. But this is a nice.
Sure.
Thank you again,
Tom. My pleasure.
Tom,
my pleasure.
Take good care, and. Thank you all for joining us again for another exciting episode of In the Stacks by the Sea. Take care. Thank you.
last one.
Come inside.